Hello, my name is Kurt Worley. I am the quantitative analyst at fxbootcamp.com. Today is Wednesday, December 2nd, 2009. This is your New York session video technical briefing. It's a video review of some of the things we covered in the live class today at fxbootcamp.com during the New York session. Now, before I get started, I'd like to request your feedback on this video. Whether you're watching this video on FX Bootcamp's YouTube page or on our Facebook page or possibly from a link on the FX Bootcamp's Twitter page or even on our blog, please leave a comment when you are done watching, even if you just say hi or thanks. I would really appreciate that. Now I'd like to clarify that the purpose of FX Bootcamp is education. This is not an alert service. The current coaches do not make trade recommendations. However, we do provide real-time technical and fundamental analysis to help you put together your trade plans throughout the day. We assume that our newer Bootcamp members are trading on a demo account, so that regardless of whether or not any particular trade plan is successful, they will certainly have an opportunity to learn and eventually trade their own live accounts for years to come, both profitably and independently. What you now see is a view showing two charts for the Euro-USD currency pair as they looked at 8:30 a.m. New York time on GFT's DealBook 360 trading platform using FX Bootcamp's custom layout. On the left is a 15-minute chart, and on the right is an hourly chart with daily pivot points and Fibonacci extensions of yesterday's range. Now, if you watched my video review of yesterday's New York session, you know that the Euro drifted marginally higher during the session into yesterday's London close. Now, I've got this 15-minute chart zoomed out to show the price action since yesterday's London close. And hey, what can I say? You don't need to be a quant to conclude that the euro has been flat since then. Now, we did have one news release which presented some potential to spark a move. I'm talking about the ADP employment report released at 8:30 a.m. Eastern Time. The headline figure from that report roughly matched market expectations, and the reaction on the euro does seem to tell a story. I've circled a type of candlestick known as a doji. Actually, it's a little hard to see. It's a little bit obscured with all the moving averages there. The candlestick looks basically like a cross like that. That typically represents indecision in the market, which is exactly what we've had in spades today. So there was ample reason to be conservative when considering trades involving the U.S. dollar today. Now, if you were ultra conservative, you could have simply trapped this pair with support and resistance lines, then simply wait for price to break outside of that trap. On the euro, I define resistance at today's highs using a horizontal black line, much like the one drawn near the top of this chart. For support, I picked this swing low at about 1.5065. That price level at 1.5065 is in the vicinity of the October high for this pair, and it was roughly the middle, 5065, roughly the middle of a 10 pip range the euro spent the better part of 4 hours in during yesterday's London session. So you now have a range of about 40 pips, and you could simply wait for the euro to break outside of that range, then look for an entry to a trade in the direction of the breakout move on a pullback. Now back to that earlier bounce near 5065. Talking about this V-shaped bounce here. When I see a V-shaped bounce like that, I naturally want to look for reasons why it bounced there. Now, one reason I found during the early part of today's London lunch session was an uptrend support line, which runs roughly through here like that. Now, I've got a separate 15-minute chart with that indicators that I want to show you, which should make it easier to spot the combination of swing lows that I used to identify that trend line. The 15-minute chart you now see is zoomed out to show the price action beginning at last Thursday's London Open. Now, if you take the dots that I've just drawn based on the real bodies of the 15-minute candles, which form last Friday's low, yesterday's low, and the low established just a few hours ago, then you connect those dots with a line and extend that line forward in time. Voila, just like that, you get a trend line which the euro encounters at the New York Open in the area of 1.5080. Right in here. A bootcamper who goes by Kevin confirmed that he also saw the same trend line, so I named this Kevin's trend line. Again, Kevin's trend line. Congratulations, Kevin. Now I'm going to switch to a 3-minute chart without indicators zoomed in to show the previous 8 hours of price action. I find it interesting that even on a 3-minute chart where you can see plenty of so-called noise or meaningless random price action, the euro in this case seems to respect Kevin's trend line, even during the minutes following the release of the ADP report in here. The trend line seems to come into play as a source of support. Now fast forward 30 minutes. And now we've got what appears to be a trend line break. Now if you're a boot camper or even a regular viewer of the FX Bootcamp videos, you can probably recall the coach is referring to a concept called role reversal. Again, that is role reversal. That's when a former source of support becomes resistance or a former source of resistance becomes support. Now that concept applies not only to levels of horizontal support or resistance, but it also applies to trend lines. This uptrend support line, Kevin's trend line, defined by the price action from last Friday and yesterday, appears to have been a source of support on two occasions today. Obviously back here around London Open, and of course in through here. Now that the trend line has been broken, it may, just may, become a source of resistance if tested later. In this case, later came nearly 2 hours after the trend line was broken. And here we are 2 hours later. Okay, let's be honest. Is this a great trade setup? Not really. Now why? All the euro has done is return to the middle of the 40-ish pip range that I defined earlier. I generally do not like to go long or short in the middle of a defined range like this. But in this case, based on a trend line retest, especially if you're already sitting on profits earned, say, earlier in the day during prior sessions, you could justify taking a speculative scalp short when you consider that, especially since today's London Open. This is poised to become, I'm highlighting some now, this is poised to become the latest in a series of lower highs. Series of lower highs suggests down. So maybe you lower your risk by taking on a position at a half of your normal lot size. So if you took the shot, you're in just below 1.5090 at about the point where the trend line and price meet. You're in right around here. Your stop loss is initially positioned 50 pips above your entry for catastrophic protection purposes. And as for an exit strategy, I don't like giving much wiggle room for a setup of arguably mediocre quality. I actually like the idea of bailing out for a very, very small loss if the euro rises above the recent swing high at about 1.5095 right there. Oh, by the way, to confirm that the trend line retest does in fact hold, you can use the 1-minute chart. Here's the test of the retest of the trend line on the 1-minute chart. And as that was occurring, Stochastics was in the overbought area, just where you'd want it if you're looking to go short. Stochastics in the overbought area on the 1-minute chart. So as Stochastics crosses after the retest of the former uptrend support line, Kevin's trend line that is, that Stochastics cross could be your signal to enter the short trade. So again, you're in at about 1.5088, let's say. Back on the 15-minute chart. Moving forward in time, 15-minute increments. About an hour after the short trade entry, the dollar rallies across the board and the euro breaks below our support line at 1.5065. Now you move your stop loss to the break-even point when the trade was about 15 pips in profit, and now that we've broken below support, now you can justify locking in some of this move as profit. 15 pips is a standard initial level of profit that we generally recommend at FX Bootcamp. We refer to that as minimal acceptable performance, or MAP. Another option, especially if you treated this as a purely scalp trade, would have been to take profit somewhere down in here, just above 1.5040. That is probably where you would have closed the trade after seeing a bounce up from 1.5040, which is where the 5 EMA on the daily chart was parked at about that time. Now, say if you took profit at 1.5045, you earned about 40 pips on that short trade. As London Close approached, the euro retested the support at 1.5065, including, by the way, the 200 EMA. 200 EMA is the green line, the horizontal green line on this chart. And then the euro dropped back down, only to stall again in the 1.5040 area after London Close, represented by the vertical red line. Now, if you were conservative and waited for the break of support, you might have taken the short on the retest of support again at 50.65 right in here. Now the weakest aspect of that setup, quite frankly, was just time of day. It was so close to London close, after which the lion's share of the trading world is out for the day. But there was some 20 pips of profit to be had for those who shorted, who took that particular short trade. Now I've got to say, it was not a stellar day for currency traders. Those were not what I considered to be premium trade setups on the euro for different reasons. However, if you did emerge with profits, that's great. If you merely survived, or better yet, if you learn something about trading or even about yourself during the course of today's sessions, then that is worth far more than any pips you did or did not earn. Again, my name is Kurt Worley, and this has been your New York session video briefing from fxbootcamp.com for Wednesday, December 2nd.